Hello, you are welcome to this session where we are going to look at the amino acids in details. The reason as to why we are going to first look at the amino acids is because we cannot understand the protein synthesis under cell biology without first appreciating the amino acids. You will see that amino acids are the building blocks of peptides, polypeptides, and proteins, which are fabrics or the raw materials of our body tissues, organs, physiological, and biochemical molecules. When I talk about the physiological molecules, you need to know that the hemoglobin is one of those. Hemoglobin that is housed within our red blood cells, you know what it does. It is responsible for transportation of oxygen into within our bodies and carbon dioxide as well. Then if you look at molecules like myoglobin that is found in the muscles, also important in the transport of oxygen at the skeletal muscular level, you see that all those are physiological proteins that do perform a lot of functions. You know that if not all the enzymes, you know that they are made up of proteins. And you know that when the amino acids come together, they form peptides. And when many peptides come together, they form polypeptides. And when several polypeptides come together, they form what you call a protein. So at this juncture, that's why we see many enzymes being actually made out of proteins. That's why we even say that enzymes are proteins in nature. So at certain temperatures, they are denatured. And for example, at low temperatures, below the optimum, you see that they are inactivated. Then at high temperatures, above, for example, 37, 38, they start undergoing denaturation like that. Then, as we see, from, of course, the amino acids, we see that we end up forming proteins, and we are going to see that proteins at this point are also organized in levels according to structure. For example, we have the primary structure. When we talk of the primary structure of the protein, there we are referring to the amino acid residues. Like we see actually our residues in various parts of the proteins. Then we also have the secondary structure. When you look at the secondary structure, we have, for example, molecules like the alpha helix arranged in such structures. Then we do have the tertiary structure. Under tertiary structure, it's where we see polypeptide chains coming together and a bit of folding slightly to form that structure. Then lastly, we have the quaternary structure, which is the last level of protein organization that are assembled in units. So for example, if you look at a molecule like hemoglobin, hemoglobin is actually super coiled, is at the level of the quaternary structure. But all these are levels of protein organization. You see that amino acids fall into two classes. And these classes are essential amino acids and non-essential amino acids. And together, there are 20 in number. However, we also have other rare amino acids that give us actual proteins at the end. But these the 20 amino acids that we are going to focus on are mainly important in the formation of body tissues, body organs, and the entire organism in general. So you see that the essential amino acids are 9 in number, and non-essential amino acids are 11 in number. When you sum them up, it gives us 20 as the total. So we are going to focus, of course, number one, we are going to begin with the essential amino acids. And these are not, the essential amino acids are not synthesized in our bodies mainly. However, of course, like we are going to see, at some points, they can be synthesized in our bodies, but through actually a lot of processes. So, these essential amino acids, you see that we mainly get them from the diet, from the food that we consume on a daily basis. However, they can also be synthesized, like I have said, they can also be synthesized from metabolic precursors that mainly come from carbohydrate metabolism, especially glycolysis, Krebs cycle, tricarboxylic acid cycle, and the pentose phosphate pathway. These amino acids include the 9 that I have actually cited somewhere, and we still have histidine, isoleucine, leucine, lysine, valine, methionine, threonine, tryptophan, and phenylalanine. So those amino acids fall in the family or in the category of the essential amino acids. Mainly, we get them from the diets. The rarely are they synthesized from our bodies. However, when the worst come to the worst, they are synthesized, but through a series of reactions that are energy consuming. So in category number 2 of amino acids, we have non-essential amino acids. These are easily synthesized or manufactured by our bodies, and they include glutamate, glutamine, proline, arginine, serine, glycine, cysteine, aspartate, asparagine, alanine, and tyrosine. And like we are going to see, you see that the tyrosine can also be derived from another amino acid called the phenylalanine in the mammals. And we, the human beings, we are part of course, the mammals. So our amino acids that I have mentioned are these. We have histidine, we have isoleucine, we have leucine, lysine, valine. You know this one, when it comes to the pathology or the mutagenesis of that results into sickle cell disease. You know what happens? You know that it undergoes actually substitution. Forgetting the descriptive terminology, but what I know it is that it is the reciprocal translocation or reciprocal substitution of valine as replacing glutamate at position 6 in a beta-globin chain J, resulting into defective hemoglobin that undergoes biocrystallization or polymerization when the oxygen tension reduces at the red blood cell level. So we have methionine, we have threonine, tryptophan, and phenylalanine. So these 9 are our essential amino acids. And as you can see, our non-essential ones, the glutamate up to the end, up to the last one, which is tyrosine, that I have mentioned. So in summary, these are the 2 categories of our amino acids that total up to 20. 9 essential ones and 11 non-essential ones. So most of them are derived from these precursors. As you can see, I have grouped them into you can see the heading amino acid biosynthetic families as grouped by metabolic precursors. You know, in this category of the first category of these amino acids, we have the under alpha keto glutarate or alpha keto glutaric acid. In our biochemistry, we looked at We looked at the carbohydrate metabolism, and under carbohydrate metabolism, we saw Krebs cycle or tricarboxylic acid cycle, whereby alpha ketoglutarate happens to be one of the intermediate precursors in that biochemical reaction. So this intermediate precursor from carbohydrate metabolism, when it is able to give us actually the alpha carbohydrate or alpha ketoglutarate carbon skeleton, and that skeleton is joined to an amino group, and together, and in the end, we form the amino acids. And the amino acids that we form here, they are, we have glutamate, glutamine, proline, and arginine. At the end, as we go through this subchapter, we are going to appreciate also the structures of the body, the body structures, raw materials that build our tissues, actually coming from some of these amino acids. Then in group number two, we have 3-phosphoglycerate. I'm sure you know this intermediate product as well in a glycolytic pathway. Still glycolysis, I remember when we are defining it, we say that glycolysis is the process by which glucose is broken down or metabolized in absence of oxygen. And I say that glycolysis occurs or takes place from within the cytoplasm, whereas the tricarboxylic acid cycle or Krebs cycle occurs particularly within the mitochondria. So from this intermediate product of glycolysis, we have amino acids, especially these three, being derived. So serine, we have our serine, we have our glycine, we have our cysteine. And you know, as we are going to see, you see that glycine is one of the raw materials of hemoglobin synthesis. So we are going to see, we are going to reach there. So you hear still, this one gives us carbon skeletons. This intermediate product gives us carbon skeleton, and the carbon skeleton is joined onto an amino group, and eventually when it is joined, we end up forming serine, glycine, and cysteine. Still, we have the next product or the intermediate precursor, which is seen in our Krebs cycle again, is our oxaloacetic acid or oxaloacetate. And from oxaloacetate, we get amino acids like aspartate, asparagine, methionine, threonine, and lysine, meaning that oxaloacetate, this byproduct, this intermediate product or precursor from carbohydrate metabolism, donates the carbon skeleton. This is the carbon skeleton that I'm talking about. The methyl group here is the one of the carbon skeletons. Then it is joined to an amino group, and eventually we form these five amino acids. And pyruvate is a common figure in as far as metabolism is concerned. Pyruvate metabolism is an important precursor in as far as metabolism, carbohydrate metabolism is concerned. I remember we see our pyruvate as one of the last byproducts in the glycolytic pathway, and at a certain stage, it is the one that is shunted into the Krebs cycle or the tricarboxylic acid cycle for further generation of ATP molecules in a series of reactions where 32 ATP molecules are formed. You remember. So we're under this, from this product, where amino acids like alanine, valine, leucine, isoleucine are derived. Then, in another category of precursor molecules, we have phosphoenolpyruvate and erythrose-4-phosphate. Phosphoenolpyruvate is also derived from the glycolytic pathway. And erythrose 4-phosphate is an intermediate precursor from pentose phosphate pathway. You remember, I hope you still recall the other, that pathway where we get pentose sugars, the 5-carbon sugars that act as the raw materials for adenosine triphosphate, for nucleic acids like deoxyribonucleic acid, ribonucleic acids, and so many others, and so many others like the category of the nucleosides. So in the nucleotides. Then from these byproducts, or from these intermediate precursors, from the two, from glycolysis and the pentose phosphate pathway, we get tryptophan, amino acid, phenylalanine, and tyrosine. And lastly, the last category of biosynthetic or metabolic precursor family, we have ribose 5-phosphate, which is also important, which you commonly see in the pentose phosphate pathway. And the ribose phosphate pathway, we have one amino acid, which is histidine, being derived from it. So, my dear colleagues, brothers and sisters, at this point, we can proceed to the next subchapter under still amino acids, and we appreciate the most and prominent byproducts that are derived from these amino acids. Welcome to this subchapter where we are going to discuss briefly about uncommon amino acids and their functions. In addition to the 20 common amino acids, proteins may contain residues created by modification of common residues already incorporated into a polypeptide. Among these amino acids, we have hydroxyproline as number one. Five hydroxylysine, 6 N-methyllysine, gamma carboxyglutamate, desmosine, and selenocysteine. These amino acids, for example, you see that 4-hydroxyproline is a derivative of proline amino acid. We saw our proline here, and so when it is hydroxylated, we end up forming actually our product called proline. I'm very, very sure most of us now understand vitamin C. And at the same time, we also understand the meaning of collagen. So, but before we complete, let's look at these two together. This is 5-hydroxylysine. You'll see that the former, which is hydroxyproline, is found in plant cell wall proteins, and both, I mean 4-hydroxyproline and 5-hydroxylysine, are found in collagen, which is the fibrous protein of most of our connective tissues. And I hope from our histology, you are aware that we have several types of collagen fibers, ranging from type 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and latest researches in our histology give us even up to collagen type 6 that are distributed in various organs that form various tissues of our organ systems. So you see that during the hydroxylation process of both proline and lysine amino acids, at such stages we see various coenzymes coming in, and the main one being the one coming from vitamin C. So that's the reason as to why when you look at the functions of vitamin C in our diet, as far as the healing of the wounds is concerned, in as far as the bone formation, teeth formation and teeth growth is concerned, we see, and also generally in many other soft tissues, we see vitamin C actually playing a key role. So what vitamin C does is to provide the hydroxyl group in hydroxylation of these two amino acid residues that culminate into the formation of collagen during the cross-linking processes by some of the enzymes like lysyl oxidase and others that I cannot be able to retrieve at this point. So when we look at this amino acid, which is number three, 6N-methyl-lysine, this one is a constituent of myosin, which is our contractile protein of muscles. I hope you still recall the ultrastructure or the histological structure of our muscle tissue. You know we have the protein called the myosin. Myosin, remember, in the contraction is where myosin head actually performs a very, very key role in contraction. Myosin acting, having an enzymatic activity at some point. So, number four, we have gamma carboxyglutamate or gamma carboxyglutamic acid. This rare amino acid is a constituent, or it is found in the blood clotting protein, prothrombin, and in certain other proteins that bind calcium as part of their biological function. You remember, when we are talking about gamma carboxylation of these proteins, we saw vitamin K playing a key role in as far as the clotting function of blood is concerned. So at this point, you can see that it is gamma carboxylation of glutamic acid which is able to reach this stage or this important stage in the presence of course of vitamin K, you remember. Number five, we have our desmosin, which is a more complex rare protein and is derived from lysine steel amino acid or lysine residue, and it is found mainly in the fibrous protein called elastin. You know, elastin is an elastic protein that is predominantly found in our elastic tissues, we shall see at the tissue levels when we cover histology in details. And lastly, we saw our selenocysteine, which is still a special case. This one is a special case, amino acid. It is really very rare amino acid residue, and it is introduced during protein synthesis rather than created through a post-synthetic modification. And like you have heard the term selenocysteine, it contains selenium rather than the sulfur of cysteine we know. And as it is derived from cysteine, from serine rather, it is derived from serine, amino acid residue. And it happens to be a constituent of a few known proteins in our body. The molecules derived from amino acids that we have so far discussed. You see that in general, like we saw in the introductory part of this subchapter, we saw that our amino acids are the building blocks of the proteins, and they are also precursors of many special biomolecules like we are going to see. Our amino acids are important, our bodies use them in the formation or biosynthesis of hormones. Like you already know, most hormones are grouped actually according to their structure, also their structural makeup. Like for example, we still have amino acid hormones like adrenaline, like noradrenaline, dopamine is a neurotransmitter, you leave it out. We have peptide hormones, protein hormones like insulin, We have glycoprotein hormones like human chorionic gonadotropin, gonadotropin, ootropin, follicle-stimulating hormone. All those are hormones basically that are proteins that are derived from amino acids and proteins. Then you also, I can also still recall some other hormones like iodinated amines or iodinated amino acids. For example, thyroxine hormone, OT4, triiodothyronine hormone, OT3, collectively known as the thyroid hormones. All those are amino acids that are iodinated or that carry iodine atoms. We see also nucleotides. Nucleotides, biomolecules like nucleotides are derived from amino acids. You know, I hope you still recall the de novo pathway and salvage pathways that are important in the biosynthesis of the nitrogen bases that are important in the building up of the nucleotides. Then we have the cell wall polymers. All those are derived from amino acids. We have porphyrins in the formation of hemoglobin in erythropoiesis. We can recall our porphyrins and the function of porphyrin in as far as the heme function is concerned. We have also many pigments that come from still these amino acids. Coenzymes, alkaloids, antibiotics as well. You know that some of the antibiotics that we know are amino acids in nature, like an antibiotic cycloserine, which is used in the treatment or management of mycobacterial tuberculosis, or tuberculosis if I generalize. We know many neurotransmitters which are found in the nervous system, particularly in the brain. You know, a neurotransmitter like glycine itself, in the central nervous system, it functions as a neurotransmitter. We know glutamate or glutamic acid is a neurotransmitter in our central nervous system. So let us look at the common neurotransmitters, the common amino acids, and what they do. We have seen an amino acid like glycine. Glycine is important in the formation of porphyrins. And the porphyrins, you know, are components of the heme proteins that come together with the cytochromes, of course, at the mitochondrial level to form actually hemoglobin structure. Then, at this juncture, when we reach at this juncture or this point, allow me to advise you to read about porphyrias. Porphyrias are disorders that result from, of course, abnormal metabolism of hemoglobin. Then we see also the same glycine, of course, like I have said, giving us the molecule heme or the component heme, which is part of hemoglobin. And it is from heme that we get biropigments, and you know the importance of biro in as far as our digestive function is concerned. You know that within the biropigments, it's where we have our biosolids like sodium glycochlorate, sodium tolochlorate, that are important in emulsification of fats that are emulsified eventually and further broken down into small lipid droplets that can be easily absorbed within our intestine. You see that from heme still, heme which is derived from our glycine, heme also contains iron. Iron, I think, in which form it is, I think the ferric state, which is iron-3, we also see bilirubin coming from him. So, as you see, bilirubin, like I said, bilirubin in the form of urobilinogen that is oxidized to urobilin when urine comes into contact with air, we see bilirubin, that color, the amber color of urine, or golden like color of urine coming actually from urobilin, which and urobilin comes from where? From bilirubin. So and the bilirubin, when you trace back where it comes from, it is from glycine amino acid. So like you can still recall from our hymn group, we also get bilirubin still, which contains free iron 3 and together with the carbon monoxide when at the end of the reaction. And when we mention carbon monoxide, we know it as a poison which binds actually onto hemoglobin irreversibly, causing actually a lack of oxygen that can be used for oxidative phosphorylation, where ATP is generated. So you can see just from just the heme alone and hemoglobin alone, you can see that glycine amino acid is important. Then we also need, by the way, before we leave this small sub-chapter, we need to appreciate that bilirubin is actually one of the most important antioxidants that we have in our mammalian tissues. It is responsible for most antioxidant activity in our serum, or you know that serum and plasma in general. So when you look at these amino acids, we should not always just stop at the academic purposes at passing our exams and maybe talking about them and leave them there. They're important in as far as life is concerned. They're important in as far as our body physiology, our homeostasis is concerned. Then we also see our glycine amino acid combining with another amino acid that we saw, arginine, forming what we call creatine. And creatine also combines with the phosphate groups to form what we call phosphocreatine. And phosphocreatine acts as an energy buffer in our skeletal muscles. So that's why when we say among the waste products that we use, in ascertaining the normal kidney function, we have one of the products called the creatinine. Creatinine is a product that comes from from the skeletal muscles, so skeletal muscle metabolism. So from today, you need to know that phosphocreatine is a product of glycine and arginine amino acids coming together to form creatine, which combines with the phosphate groups to form what we call phosphocreatine. And phosphocreatine acts as an energy buffer in our skeletal muscles. Then another category of the byproducts that we should look at, we should not forget our methionine. Methionine, in the form of S, adenosylmethionine, is important in the transfer, or is important in the as a methyl group donor. You remember in when we are looking at vitamin B12 and folic acid metabolism, somewhere we saw S adenosylmethionine. And it is in this reaction where methionine acts as a methyl group donor in the formation, in the metabolism of those two vitamins that I have mentioned, B12, and which is cyanocobalamin, and folic acid, which is pteroglutamic acid, or vitamin B9. We have also another amino acid, which is actually currently, it is called, that amino acid is erofluoroalanine. Erofluoroalanine is currently being tested as an antibacterial drug, and probably we hope that it actually works out in the next maybe like 2 or 3 years, so that we also count it on the list of our important or essential antibacterials or antibacterial drugs. Like I said, allow me to give you the spelling. Alanine. Like you can see, elo stands for revo. Revo, then fluoro, it means it has the fluorine component, then alanine. Alanine is our amino acid that we saw.